ice cream over here, not stream. I would burn it up and chill of everything I used to be. You're my rock of empathy, you might. So come on,
is enough of that. Hello everyone, and welcome to the Triathlon Nutrition webinar. How are we all doing tonight? I'm assuming you can all hear me. Can you just pop a little message in there? Let us know where you're from and we can get going. The only reason I'm stalling right now is because I'm just trying to close iTunes, which is a bit of an amateur mistake. Okay, you guys can all hear me. Sweet. Before we get going, you're going to have to excuse the farmer accent. So please just let me know if there's any issues. If there are any issues, there's nothing I can do with it, because at Norwich, we have one road in, one road out. So, and Mark, being from Wales as well, you've probably got a little bit of an accent. So we can emphasize with each other. We've got loads of accents in here. Dublin, that is an amazing accent. Lincoln. Cool. Well, thank you for joining me here for this Triathlon Nutrition. As we said, we've done the webinar before. I want to do it again and do it better and do it for you guys and get things going, because there's a lot of things which can be improved on in Triathlon Nutrition and just getting the basics right, which is what we're going to go through. So, welcome. Well, who is this for? This is for you. This is for our triathletes that you're concerned with your nutrition potentially. If not, why would you have just clicked and registered? So thank you for joining me. It's for people that, You may have reached your peak and you want to achieve that next level of performance. Or, as I spoke to someone else, he wants to beat his mates as well. So he wants to get that peak. And here's what you're going to learn today. Right, so first things first, we're going to learn how many carbs, fats, proteins you should eat. And also the surprising truth that none of it will matter if you get one crucial part wrong. Okay, you're going to discover that calorie balance and what type you're going to risk, like a loss of performance if you're in the wrong one, if you're having a positive and so on. So we're going to answer how many extra calories you need to eat for optimal body recovery. The problem with all calculators, how to fix them, and they're going to work for you. But most of all, you're going to learn food is the key to unlocking your peak performance. Now, before we go any further, pop in the little chat box. Just let me know what foods you think I'm going to tell people to eat that you absolutely bloody hate eating day in, day out. But everyone's like, oh, that's a clean food. I've got to eat that clean food. Like with me, it'll be stuff like, oh, let's have boiled potatoes and broccoli every single day. So let's see on there, because the trouble that we have with nutrition is there are a lot of different views out there. And I don't want to be giving people ideas that they're going to have to eat foods they don't like. Boring, plain, dry foods just to get their performance. Okay, food is a fuel, but food can also be enjoyed. And we want to make sure we can let you enjoy that. So porridge. Okay, I'm actually like, I must be one of them random ones that absolutely love porridge, although I do put chocolate in it, so that kind of helps. So it might be the chocolate that helps me like it. Fish as well. Fish is so boring. Like, I remember eating fish day in, day out, just back when, I think it's my student days, of just had to eat fish and tuna from the tin, choking on tuna. That was nasty. So we want to make sure we look at the options of nutrition and what we're going to be able to put in your plans. So as a bonus, I'm going to offer you something small, but remember, like, a lot of you have actually sent through the reasons why you need nutrition coaching. And don't let me forget, because sometimes being a geek, I do tend to get a bit carried away. I'm going to give someone a free nutrition coaching package. So make sure I don't carry it away. When we get to the Q&A, just mention it if I haven't gone through it already. So that's just a bonus there. And I've kind of given that Q&A thing away. So with the food diaries that we said about, this is going to give you a chance to just look through, and any questions you've got coming off them. Have you been eating too much of a certain thing? Have you been eating too much kale, Dwayne? Have you been eating too much fish, Mark? And George, have you been eating too much porridge? So let's get going. So shut down the cell phone, lock the doors, and prepare yourself. Does it sound like you? You want to come better prepared to train harder? You want to feel like you've got unlimited energy and you're worried you are going to bonk during training, or worse? I've seen a hell of a lot worse than bonking. I've literally not been able to do any more. The psychological barrier is there. Are you worried it's going to bonk when it counts? So do you feel you've invested too much time to even invite the opportunity for failure? The good news is nutrition is going to sort that. So as soon as you invest in your nutrition, you're not going to have to worry about these things. I mean, we can't worry about mechanical stuff like that, but no amount of porridge is going to fix loads of punctures and mechanics going wrong. And this is about to change. Remember, performance is always going to be the key with our sport. Now, I want to get a quick poll in here. How much percentage do you think that nutrition is going to add already on top of your performance? So say already you're at 100% performance, how much more percent are you going to add on top of that by nutrition? The reason being is, as soon as we see how much nutrition is going to add to it, we can start to believe that as well. So you can have as many turbo sessions. You can spend as much money on the turbos, on different turbos as you like. You can spend as much money getting lighter wheels, lighter pedals, more streamlined bike fit and different tri-suits. But we can look into that different percentages of nutrition and what is going to happen with that. We can soon see where we're going to benefit. Okay, we're getting the results coming in now. Exactly. So, I mean, no one's gone for the 0 to 25. although someone will probably go and press it now, said that. But we're looking at like 75 to 100. Like, it makes a massive amount of difference. So basically, nutrition is going to be just as key as your other sessions on there. And a lot of people have actually discussed it and said it's the fourth discipline. That's going to be the same in any aspect and anywhere you go with triathlon. So if you want to maximize your performance, you need to know two things. You need to understand your calorie needs, and you need to understand how to satisfy those needs with the macronutrients. So what we mean by that, the proteins, the carbs, the fats will determine your caloric needs, how you're going to satisfy them. But first off, who is me? Who's Ollie Matthews? I was a fat boy turned thin. I'd actually lost a couple of stone on that delightful picture on the left. And then I went to bodybuilding. Now, people have made that mistake because I'm not a bodybuilder now. And some people have thought, because he's a bodybuilder, he can't teach train triathletes in nutrition. I've had 10 years experience in nutrition, helping different athletes in different distances. So this is not a mistake to be made on there. We've been published in Men's Fitness, Bonk Triathlon, I'm a sponsored athlete, a personal trainer magazine, Juggernaut Training Systems, and a sponsored athlete, sponsored nutritionist of Protein Dynamics, and also published and paid publishing in there. I come from a family of endurance athletes. I work with triathletes worldwide. I've got a podcast, and I'm also a coach for a company called Complete Human Performance. So this is what I'm doing. Beyond the Champion Show, but most importantly of all, I've got a dog, Dexter, and no doubt throughout the presentation, he might jump in. So I'm going to make sure I don't share my screen so you can see him because he's a little git. When he wants something, he can open doors now. So on to the good stuff. First things first, though, before we do that, let's go for another poll or just type in there. What event are you doing and when is it going to be? Is it going to be like 3 months, 6 months, 9 months, 12 months, because we're getting closer and closer to the season every day that passes. So let's just have a look at that. So let me go into the polls. So because what we want to make sure is that when you get your nutrition, it's not going to be a rush job. It's not going to be a case of you need to change this and that today. You need to make sure that you've got yourself plenty of time to look into doing it. So what I say to people is that if it's going to be next week, there's only a limited amount we can look at. We can have a look at a little bit of race day, but we need these basics to be sorted first. So your race day nutrition is going to be good, but unless you fix these nutritional mistakes, eat enough, eat the right things in your training day in, day out, then that race day nutrition is going to be a little bit pushed to the side and not get the most of it. So we've got about 3 months, 6 months. Cool. So we've got a lot of people which are more like 6 months, 7 to 10 months, and that's good because 6 months seems to be like a very good position to be in when it comes to like working with nutrition, because we want to make sure, as we said, we've got that time to work together, see what works for you as an individual. Because when we look at different plans as well, like a lot of you will be familiar when it comes to like the Dom Fink like training plans and things like that. They're not necessarily tailored specifically to the individual. And that's the same when it comes to nutrition. So there's going to be certain things that we put into a plan, obviously foods you don't like, but we need to know how your body reacts to certain things. We need to make sure that is tailored specifically to you. So let's get going. I'm going to stop all my nattering and get going onto the stuff you really want to know. Have you achieved a calorie balance? So what we mean by that, basically negative red balance. We've got the balanced calorie balance. We've got the positive one. Basically, if you want to gain weight, you need to eat more. If you want to drop weight, you need to eat less. I think in one of the groups today, someone was saying that he'd put on a lot of weight coming from a sedentary lifestyle, and he put on muscle because that's what happens when he's gone on his rides. So it was asking what to do. Now, the simple thing to look at that is to drop weight, you need to eat less. And a couple of people have pointed out in there, and that is the case, but we want to make sure that if that person does need to drop weight, he does it at a level which doesn't affect his performance. So ideally, where we will be in, as soon as we get to race weight, we will be in a balanced calorie state. So that means we're going to be eating roughly the same amount of calories as we burn day in, day out. And we're focused on performance, right? So from a performance perspective, are you eating enough? And as you can guess, that age-old question when it comes to fitness and any sort of health side of things, when it comes to your triathlon training, is going to be, it depends. And also, it's going to depend not just on your day-to-day training. It's also going to depend on your lifestyle. So whether you're going to be running around after your kids, left, right, and center, whether you have to go and take the wife to work, pick her up, she's causing stress, and the husband as well. We cause a hell of a lot of stress as well, ladies. So is that going to then have to be taken into account? And so we'll want to look into that. How much do you work out? That's going to be the big thing there. So I've seen athletes work out from like, for Ironman distances, around sort of 10, 15 hours, working up to 20 hours, 25 hours. And some of the pros I've worked with have gone up to about 40, 45 hours. Obviously, it's their job. They can recover a bit more, and they need to do that to actually get to the levels they want, they need to be to earn their money. So how much do you work out? And also, what about when you're not training? So as we've mentioned, have you got your family, you're at home, and you're looking after your children? You want the energy to make sure you're doing that. So are you at work doing a 9-to-5? Is that going to be manual labor? Is that going to be scanning Facebook while the boss isn't looking? And these sort of things. Or it's come to a Friday afternoon and you're bored, so you start going on different triathlon sites and end up buying new wetsuits. What is your health like? Now, this is going to be one of the biggest things which people seem to neglect. And it sounds a bit weird to look at on there. Why would you neglect your health? Now, with that, your health is going to be the biggest thing which is going to increase your performance. And what you feed your body is going to be what makes your health better or worse. And we need to look at certain things like, have you had a really, really bad illness when you were younger? Has your stomach and your gut suffered as an effect of that? Is your immune system lower as an effect of that? And these are certain things which are going to actually make a difference when it comes into the nutrition for the actual tasks we need to undertake daily. Excuse me. So before we worry about the types of food, we need to know, are you simply getting enough? Now, we mentioned about calculators, and there are a few ways we can find out. So we enter the basal metabolic rate. This is basically, I'm sure you guys would have heard of this sort of thing, the amount of calories you burn sitting on your bum doing nothing all day long. So not talking about Netflix and chill, we're just talking about chilling, watching Netflix, doing nothing. Okay, so for example, myself, 200 pounds, 5'8", that's nice and tall, by the way, 172 centimeters, not short, it's average. Trains 5 times a week, 2 hours a day. So we're looking at around 10 hours worth of training. See, I'm on there using the BMR, around 2,000 calories a day, doing nothing but living, which is still a lot of calories there. And then when you look at that activity multiplier, which is why things need to be taken into account, they're going to be different ones. So we're looking at a pretty high level multiplier there of 1.7. Now, we want to look per activity at another method. So we've got the calculators and they're good. Okay. But once we get that BMR, we can also look at another way. So we can work out specifically for your swim, bike, run, what we are going to be doing. You could also look into if you're doing any sort of weight training, S&C work as well. So per activity swimming, remember this is a rough guideline amount. Potentially it could be like 2.7 or 3.1, but on average, the science has said that 2.9 calories per mile per pound is what you're going to burn when swimming. This is when swimming. The same with the running, 0.7 calories per mile per pound. So when we take into the actual level of exertion, that's going to take a lot of into account as well. Cycling, 0.3 calories per mile per pound. We also need to remember that we need to recover. So with those calories, we need to add about 10% on top of those for additional recovery needs. Therefore, if you're going to be burning 100 calories, you need to earn another 10% on top of them, so 110 calories to include into your recovery on top of your BMR. Now, you guys are going to be doing a lot of mileages per week. I mean, roughly, how many miles would you guys cycle at the moment, bearing in mind that you guys have said what we've got? Georgia in May. It's my birthday, May the 21st. Remember that? 30th birthday. I've actually got a client doing the Lanzarote. Dave Majorca in, how many miles are you guys doing already, like, for your Ironmans in, like, May? Like, we've got Lacey doing the Chattanooga. Actually, we've got a triathlon training camp there with Complete Human Performance in August. So, Lacey, if you want some more details on that, because it's going to be all around the Chattanooga course, it'll be pretty cool to look into that. Jessica, North Carolina. So, how many miles are you guys currently putting in per week? Paris Marathon, Australia, Outlaw, and Copenhagen. I think you're showing off a bit there, Anthony. Like, that's a hell of a lot to take on there. That's amazing. Paris Marathon, there's going to be some sights there for sure. And Austria is going to be some good sights. So, I mean, 250K per week. You had to put it in kilometres, didn't you? Me being British, I work in miles. But what's that? Roughly, what? 120, 150 miles, something like that. So there's going to be a hell of a lot of mileage on there. So 80, 90 miles cycling. So when you add that with let's go back to the cycling for calories. So it's going to be, what, another like 800-900 calories that I added on top. And we can work that out through the actual calculators. So it's not that easy, unfortunately. As cool as that sounds, lots of things can affect how many calories we need. Our hormones, and us blokes do have hormones as well, ladies. So we don't get it that short. So we don't get it that easy. Things like your thyroid hormone. So how much are you going to be burning with your thyroid? I'm sure we've heard of that a lot. And stress is going to be affecting that a hell of a lot. We look at the stress levels a little bit in a while, so I won't go on about that. Testosterone levels, cortisol levels, there's going to be a hell of a lot on our hormones depending on what we're going to actually be able to burn, both resting, both recovering, and also whilst training. Calories burnt simply by digesting. Now, roughly around 10 to 15%, depending on the fiber content and different types of food, roughly around 10 to 15% of the calories we eat is burnt simply by digesting. So if we're looking for a certain amount of food to be taken in to facilitate recovery, then we need to then look at that amount of calories that are being burnt from that food by digesting. Even your core body temperature. You know these people that sometimes are just boiling hot, having to sleep in the middle of the winter, potentially got a higher, like with the window open, potentially got a much higher core body temperature. So these things are going to make a lot of difference when it comes to your nutrition and how many calories. And what calculators don't take into account are your body fat. Now, if you think of it like this, a 200-pound person with 10% body fat, 200-pound person with 20% body fat. 1 pound of fat burns around 2 calories per day. 1 pound of muscle burns around 6 calories per day. The calculators aren't necessarily going to be taking that into account. You have the activity multipliers. Now, what is wrong with them is I mentioned those guys that were pro athletes and working about 40-odd hours a week. Now, these guys, those calculators got to like 1.9. Now, some of the people that I've had to work with, and it's been amazing doing that, have gone like 2.4 when it comes to activity multipliers. It's like you're picking numbers out of the air because these different calculators, the one we were looking at earlier was the Harris-Benedict formula, they're not going to be taking into account the amount of calories these people need. And non-exercise activity thermogenesis, NEAT, basically how much someone fidgets when they get up for a drink. So you've got that annoying person at work. And if it is you, I really have no sympathy for you. That person that's swinging around on the chair, tapping the desk, knocking the desk with their knee. Your screen is shaking left to right. They're clicking their pen all the time. And yeah, quite frustrating, always getting up and down. But they're burning more calories doing it. So if you're not one of them sort of people, then maybe that's something that should become a habit, become annoying. So yeah, what do? We keep it simple, stupid. KISS principle. I'm sure you've heard that when it's come to your triathlon, your programming and those sort of things. Like, keeping it simple is usually the best thing to do, but it's also one of the hardest things to do. We forget science. We work out a starting point based on your expenditure estimates, your nutritional history, and your health history and goals. So if your goal is to drop weight or stay weight, we look at your health history as well. If your health history is you've got a slow metabolism, some hormone issues, we can sort that out with nutrition as well. Nutrition history, if you've been eating very, very low amounts and your calculators and guideline amounts tell you you should be eating 2,000 calories higher, it's not going to be as simple. And we need to work your body up for it. Because if someone is stuffed eating 1,800 calories a day, imagine how they're going to feel when they're eating 3,800 calories a day. You need to work up to that sort of thing. And that's just asking for trouble. But I'm pretty sure some of you have had some issues when it comes to the gingerbread men poking out when you're on a long run. And we've all been there. I'm fortunate enough to say when I was training for the marathons last year, there were some instances where you might have eaten a bit much the night before. And yeah, we all do it. So we want to make sure you are fueled correctly to not have much GI distress, any GI distress. And also your estimates need to be taken into account. And feedback is going to be the most amazing thing for us. So getting your FTPs, seeing what power output you're putting, see how much a certain heart rate is to do a certain mileage, how much speed you're doing in a certain zone, and how much you recover, even like your resting heart rate. If you know your resting heart rate when you wake in the morning and your body temperature, if your resting heart rate is elevated, potentially you're not eating enough, so you're not recovering enough. And we want that to be as low as possible. So track your calories, track your performance, track your energy. That's a big thing, because performance and energy are completely different. So when we say energy, I'm sleepy during the day, I'm dropping off when I'm in a meeting, and I'm just not able to focus. Your weight is going up, it's going down, it's fluctuating left, right, and center. Your performance is dipping. And you want to track your calories and your weight at the start and finish of around sort of like a 7-day period. Now, because I work closely with my clients, when we start up, we look at around sort of 4 or 5 days worth of tracking, weight before, weight after, and we look at any history we've got. If we have to look a little bit more in depth, I have had people track up to 14 days before I've changed anything in their nutrition. But then instantly, by doing this, sometimes you can get it completely spot on and not need to change anything for a month or two, which is great. So the absolute best way is going to be experience, as I've just said there. You speak to so many people who will give you so many different answers. But what we've found by working with so many people over the years is that there's no one-size-fits-all. Everything is specific to the individual. And that is why we have specialists in different areas. So now we have an idea of how many calories we need. How do we get them? It fits my macros. Now, hang on. Let me go back into, like, you can see my face on this one. I'll let you. If it fits your macros. Now, the trouble with that is that we want to make sure you have enough really good bits in your nutrition and a good percentage coming from them so you get the results you want. The trouble with if it fits your macros is, yes, it is great. It allows us to have a lot of food, and a lot of food which people would say is bad food. Now, with if it fits your macros, people will be putting ice cream in for loads of carbohydrates and sugar and fats. And what I like to do with clients is actually have around sort of 70-80% of their calories in there, and around 20% is going to be a free-for-all. Because if you think of something like, you've got 1,000 pounds, now those 1,000 pounds, that's more than you need. The thing you want costs 800 pounds. So you've got 200 pounds, you can do whatever you want. You can go and waste it, you could buy the partner a treat, but they don't even know you've got that, so you can do whatever you want with it. So having an allowance for those calories is good, but then making sure you know you've got to get enough of the good stuff, and that does not have to be porridge, it does not have to be kale, it does not have to be fish, I promise you. So let me switch back. Right. Back on the screen. Let's, before we go further with this, what is your favourite item of food? Just to chuck in there, like, you've got 200 calories, or for example, if there's 20% and you're eating 3,000 calories a day, you've then got 600 calories. That's a lot of calories. Like, I'd go to the cinema and then chuck some popcorn on there. What would be your favourite thing to put in there that you think would potentially be a bad thing for your nutrition? Just chuck it in the chat and let's see what we've got. So, like, as you say, like, mine is going to be popcorn, and I'm a massive chocolate fiend. Chocolate and peanut butter, chocolate spread and peanut butter on toast is good stuff. Trust me. If you haven't had it, then try it. What else have we got? Nachos, chili and nachos with loads of cheese. Always great. Always good to have there. Chocolate. That's going to be the biggest one. But the thing is with chocolate, it's really great to chuck in people's plans anyway. So that doesn't even need to be that 200, like 20%. But chocolate is going to be good. I mean, if you get something that's kind of low fat, chuck it in post-workout. The reason I say low fat post-workout is just because the fat is going to slow down the digestion a little bit, and we want to just get those calories doing what they need to do and helping you recover. Pizza, Dave, that's amazing. There was, like, I think it was in Tesco's, there's one for like 600 calories. So imagine that. You could have pizza every day and still get the results you need to get. That's pretty cool when I think of it like that. Chocolate cookies. Yeah, cookies are really good. You can never have one or two, especially those really nice, chewy, freshly cooked ones. You have to have the whole bag. So let's go back onto the screen. Oh, we are on the screen. Here we go. So we know what sort of foods we want in there. Like, imagine that you've got a calorie allowance and it allows you to have pizza in there, brownies, cookies, Dominoes, yep, beer. Like, even with beer, true fact of the day, I got my dog a beer on his birthday last Sunday. Suckers, bloody pet owners. Anyway, beer can be good as well. Like, obviously not too much because you're not going to be able to ride in a straight line. I don't know what the laws are against that. But let's carry on. Protein. Big word in there, but why so many different options? I've seen protein beer, protein crisps, protein pizza, protein bounties, protein sweets. Seriously, like, you put protein in front of something, and why? I mean, when I have sweets, I don't want them to be protein sweets. I just want them to be sweets. I want brownies just to be brownies. Like, we don't need to have that. So how much protein do we really need? Definitely not as much as a lot of people have, and especially when you look at the background where I've come from, then people are like, yeah, really getting a hard on for protein, and that's not cool. Like, you're just going to stink. Like, every athlete needs about 1.5 grams per pound per day. The average athlete, they have that. Protein is going to help us recover. Negative diet balance will require more protein. One of the reasons, protein is more satiating. It will keep us fuller for longer. But if you think about burns victims, now stay with me here, because burn victims, they're going to have a lot of tissue to recover. So they've got all their organs to recover. So the skin is an organ and it needs to recover. They're going to have a lot of tissue needing to recover. Now they're having something like 0.7 grams per kilo to 1.2 to 1.25 grams per kilo, and having the ability to recover. So in reality, we don't need as much protein as we think. So from experience, the baseline which I look to set with clients is about 1 to 1.25 grams per kilo per day. Now, some of us do like more protein. And as we've mentioned before, it is great to put food in that people like rather than don't like. So there's not going to be nothing wrong with having a little bit more protein. That's why we've got those free calories. It doesn't matter if you get those free calories from protein, carbs or fats. You get them from what you like. I think that chicken is a little bit underdone there, if that's what it is. No, actually, it's salmon. I'll shut up. Carbs. This is a big one. Now, if you've followed any of the stuff that I've done before or seen my little chats in different groups, now, I'm a believer in carbs for performance. And there are some studies coming which are showing fats are getting like average when it comes to fuel for endurance. When we look at the ultra triple brutals and you look at different ultra distances, there's going to be some call for fats to be performance used for performance, but carbohydrates are going to be the most beneficial thing you can get in your diet for performance. Carbs are going to be protein sparing, so you've got the carbs in your system already being able to be used for energy. That is going to be a great thing. So when we look at the different studies, one of the studies which is actually done, let me get the actual study on here. I've got it, I'm pretty sure. There will be one moment. Okay, so it was a study done. I'll just share the link if anyone wants it. But basically, it was showing the benefits of protein, carbs, and fats for fuel. And it actually turned out for 35% of your VO2 max, fats are okay for fuel. Up to 70% of your VO2 max, fats are okay for fuel. But past that, and the levels that we want to get as athletes and focused on our performance, fat stop being as good for fuel when it gets to 70% of your VO2 max. At that point, carbohydrates are going to be the best thing you can have for fuel. And I don't know if any of you guys could just do it off the top of your head, but VO2 max at 70%, that's not too fast. So we want to make sure we can get the best out of our performance. After all, what is the point of doing those 80, 90 miles a week, those 250K a week, if you're not going to be able to fuel them? Why are they important? They're fuel. Fuel for workouts and fuel for recovery and fuel for life. They keep your hunger and satiety hormones in check. So we've got hormones like ghrelin and leptin, and they keep these in check. They keep them activated, and they tell you when you're full up. They tell you if you're hungry. We need them, basically. And they're going to boost your mood by releasing serotonin. Basically, you go very low carb. I bet if you've been low carb for a while as well, you're not going to be as cheery as that. Not after a few days. So if you still feel like going low carb, your energy drops, your sex drive drops, your strength drops, your mood drops. Believe me, I've looked at a keto diet. I've been low carb, high fat, moderate carbs, and I've tried all these sorts of diets over the 10 years that I've been in the industry, and I've tried them with different clients over different distances and different sports as well. And overall, carbs have been the best fuel. So how many carbs should you be eating? The answer isn't simply all the carbohydrates. So training day carbs, 2 to 3 grams per pound of body weight, depending on the workload. Rest day carbs, around 1.5 to 2 grams per pound of body weight. Your body is still recovering and needs the fuel to make this happen. Again, we want to get as much decent intra workout nutrition as well. So that's going to be taken into account. Like, usually I will have something on there with training day carbs, and then that's a whole nother webinar when it comes to race day nutrition, because we want to make sure we get no GI distress and we're fully hydrated. So 200 pound guy, 400 to 600 grams of carbs per day, 300 on rest days at least. Fat. Now remember, fats are vital for your hormones and for your recovery, for your life. Okay? Fats are not going to clog. Dietary cholesterol is not going to affect your actual cholesterol levels 90% of the time. The small percent of the time is going to be due to like genetic dysfunction, and there's going to be different reasons there. It's not going to be down to your dietary levels. We need that cholesterol to actually help us with hormone production. We need that cholesterol to help us with healthy recovery. So we need it, basically. Hence why when we looked at like 20 years ago, everyone was saying low fat. 10 years ago, they're saying high fat. Now they're saying no sugar. Then they're saying
no red meat. But basically, it's a hell of a lot of things when it comes to marketing, and we'll get different stories in the media. Next week, they'll say, we can't eat lettuce. Don't quote me on that one. So eating cholesterol and saturated fat won't raise your blood cholesterols. Things like your genetics. If you eat a hell of a lot of junk food, smoke, and drink a lot of alcohol, not just the beers and doing the beer mile and things at Kona and at Roth, and you're going to see some, like, if any of you guys are doing Roth, then you will see some people out there that probably are going to have some issues with cholesterol levels on that beer mile. So lifestyle as well. You guys are going to be from a background where the lifestyle isn't going to be an issue for cholesterol levels. So I want to recap here. How much food? Using the BMR, got my nice smiley face on there. That looks very photoshopped from that photographer. 3,500 calories using an activity multiplier of 1.725. 200 grams at 4 calories per gram is 800 grams of protein. 800 calories from protein. Carbohydrates, 2,000. Fat, 690. Now, obviously, you can see the exact percentages there, but roughly, what I've worked out, 20-60-20 seems to be a good starting point. Now, as we've said, everyone is different. Even all you people on the call. So here today, you're going to be different. Some of you guys might need less fat. I wouldn't go below about 15% fat. You might need a little bit more protein. You might need more carbs. It's something you need to look at. And being individual, and what I've got for that small gift is going to help you. I mean, there's no point of having so much protein that you can't then have a meal with your children and not be able to include them in the meal. We like to be able to go out and enjoy the food together. We like to eat all the food. So before we get into it, into the Q&A, did we hit the main points? How many carbs, fats, and protein should you eat? And the surprising truth, none of that will matter if you get the one crucial part wrong. We got that one sorted, didn't we? You discover what your calorie balance should be without risking a loss in performance. Now, remember we said about the negative, the positive, the balanced calorie balance, and we want to stay in that sort of balanced area. Potentially when you're in the off season and you need to drop a bit of race weight, then, or of weight for race day, we look at a negative. If you need to gain a little bit of weight, you look into a positive. We went over that. How many extra calories should you eat for an optimal body recovery? Excuse me. So we went over that with the 10%. But again, it's going to vary for the individual. If you go for a rather harsh session, couldn't even say that then, a rather harsh session, then you're going to potentially need a little bit more. The problem with all calorie calculators and how to fix them so they work for you. So we went through what we need to look at, how we need to track, and what we need to look on the outcome of that tracking. If you want to compete at the max level, you need fine-tuned nutrition. And that doesn't mean, like, even if, like, you're not at a pro level, you just want to beat your mates. You want to beat the lads down the local team, down the local tri club. You want to beat them down the local bike club. You need to know how many calories required to maintain your training, how to split up the calories between the macros. Because you want that energy to train. You want the energy to recover. And you've come too far and invested too much to fail because you neglected nutrition. So we have a choice. We have A or B. This is like Matrix, red pill, blue pill. You can choose to take all the information and say, that's nice, and go back to your same old routine and personal bests. Or you can choose to compete at a higher level and crush those personal bests. So if it's a second choice, here's what I've got for you. So my team and I have put together an incredible deal. And as a thank you for attending the workshop, we're going to hop onto a call, providing you want to, that is, then find some small tweaks that make the most impact to you, completely free of charge. And if it's a good fit from there, you can set up a nutritional program with myself. So regardless, we're going to find something what we can help you with nutrition. These are some of the guys that I've worked with as well. So you don't have to take my word for it. Jeremy Howard came third at the Ultraman World Championships. So he's now doing his FTP test after the Ultraman. He's going to be doing Challenge Roth as one of the pros there this year. Hopefully be able to get over there. Glenn Thomas. Now, Glenn was really good with working with him, done everything we said, and he actually got more results than he thought. He was actually had more energy, he was more awake, and he got to spend more time with his family. Now, one of the things that he said was, this is probably only going to resonate if you're from England and you're sad enough to watch EastEnders or something like along those lines, but when Lucy Beale died, I got an email and it was saying, thank you, because I've managed to do something, because before I started with you, I had to train 5 nights a week and a Saturday. Now, this week, I took my son to play football, and on Friday night, I watched with my daughter Who Killed Lucy Beale live on EastEnders. Before, he would have been training, had to watch on catch-up or just watch on Match of the Day. So, some great results there. Because I love what you do, what I do. So if you're ready to seize the opportunity and become the athlete you want to become, let's just chat. Like, a no-obligation phone call with me, the Triathlete's Nutritionist. I am going to own that hashtag, promise. So, first things first, let's go for some questions, guys. If you just pop in there, if you've got any questions. Now, as you're doing that, what I'm going to do, I'm going to get the people up here that have actually sent in the emails. My email might just make a noise here. So fire away your questions in the box and I'll get answering them. And then we can find out who wants the free one. I think there's been 12. Yeah, there's been 12 people email me already. Makes me feel quite popular getting those emails come through. Okay, so with the questions that we've got that have come up, and some of the questions that I've been asked, because not all the guys could actually make it here, were distinguishing between good and bad carbs and when we look at intolerances. Now, it seems like intolerances have come through, and I've actually written the book on intolerances, but about a year ago there was gluten, dairy, eggs, cashews that I couldn't eat, I would just blow up. So there's no specific rule to you must eat this or must eat that when it comes to good or bad carbs. But what I like to do is look for the least processed option as possible. If you've got a food like low-fat yogurts, chances are there's some other sugar added into them. You look at the ingredients, Fahe Total Greek Yogurt, that's been strained with the fats that have come down and things like that on there. So let me pop the screen up so you can see the ugly mug. So, yeah, so have a look with your food and to see the ingredients in it. If it's got loads of things you can't pronounce, chances are it's got some processed ingredients in, and they're not going to be the best things for your body. So have them in your free calories as such. So, Anthony, been advised straight after training, I should be drinking full fat milk. Now, I like to have chocolate milk, something like that, which is going to get the low fat option. Now, the trouble with having fats straight after training, if you think about this, say you've gone for your long ride, you've gone 5-6 hours on a Sunday on your long ride. Now, with that, you've potentially had very little nutrition. So we're going to mix it in with Dwayne's question in a moment with the early morning sessions. So if you've had your breakfast, you've then gone 5 hours with having a couple of gels or some fruit, some dried fruit and some things like that, then when it comes to the end of your training and you look at how quickly you want to be able to digest your food, there's going to be food in your stomach anyway. But by the time it's gone in your mouth, through your stomach and started getting to work, you're looking at about 15-20 minutes anyway. Also, once it started getting to work, it's going to be about an hour while it's in the muscles getting your body recovered. Now, if we add fat into there, potentially it's going to slow that down. Fat is known to slow the process down, hence why when people do go on a low carb, high fat diet, they don't get too hungry because the fat is very slow digesting. And the slower that actually digests, then the longer it's going to take to help us recover, which we don't want. We want to start that recovery process as quickly as possible as soon as we finish training. Hence why when it comes to like full nutrition and race day nutrition and things like that, we want to look at getting as much as possible at the right points as possible. And sometimes like when you're finishing your longer rides, the last half an hour, you look at getting your recovery shake started then. Struggle and early morning sessions, fasted or not. That's one where we look at nutrition as a whole day. So what I say by that is that if you're getting your carbohydrates over the day and you have carbs before bed, I think, Dwayne, you said about the kale, I think, but things like oats before bed, oat cakes, something like that before bed with a banana and some milk, some nuts and stuff like that, peanut butter, are really good to help boost your serotonin levels. Now, if you're getting carbohydrates before you go to bed, then you're not going to run a marathon in your sleep. Your glycogen stores are going to be filled up unless you're some freak that decides that's probably the best time to run a marathon when you're sleeping. You haven't got to worry about it unless it's traffic. But in that when that morning comes, then if you are fasted, or fasted as we say, you're still going to have glycogen stores which are topped up. They're not going to be completely full, don't get me wrong, because you're still going to burn a little bit of glycogen just by living, but you're going to have enough to be able to fuel a good training session. Depending on how intense you are going, so if you're going to go all out, then yeah, we probably want to get a little bit in. So even if it's just going to be half a banana and half a scoop of protein or something like that, then that's cool. But fasted, if you have to train fasted, if you start work or you got to take the kids to school at 8:30 and whatever time they start, or like myself, I take my fiance to work, and you want to get your session in early. The pool opens at like 6:30 here, so I want to get there when it starts. So I don't want to get up at like 5:30, 5 o'clock just to have breakfast. So I'll get up at 5, have a quick swig of protein and like a couple of, I'll get like banana crisps from Holland & Barrett, or dried banana, and just have a couple of flakes of them, and then I'll go down and start my swim session. Badly, you do not want to see me swim. Nutrition while training. So again, the nutrition while training is going to make a lot of difference where you're training, your altitude, the climate. Where if it's hotter, it's going to be a case where potentially your body can't digest as much whole food, so you want more fluid. If it's colder, vice versa. Now, a lot of people have the issues because they have so many gels, and they end up getting a lot of sugar in their stomach, which then they have a lot of water, and it's just glugging about and sloshing around left, right, and center. Is glug even a word? And you don't want that, because that's going to be giving you a stitch and giving you loads of issues, and you end up going to need to run to the bush, which we don't want. Now, something called L-glutamine, just an amino acid. The dog is jumping at the door. Okay. So something like with an amino acid, you're going to actually see the dog now. L-glutamine is really good. That is going to help you actually. Let me push him out. One moment. Dexter, out you go.
Thanks, sir.
This is real life. We're live, folks. So yeah, with L-glutamine, we have got an amino acid which helps transport water from the gut into the cells. And with that water, it will also transport the carbohydrates as well through a process called osmosis. So that is a really good thing to have. And I know that Complete Human Performance over in America, there's going to be a formulation which is brought out over there. I don't know in the UK yet, but I've helped with Protein Dynamics to sort out their amino drink, which has got glutamine and electrolytes in there. I would then add something like waxy maize starch, so you've got some carbohydrates in there as well, but not too much. That is going to stop that sloshing about and actually let the water do work, because that's what's going to be causing the GI distress. The water staying in your stomach, that's going to make your gut sensitive. You get really fatigued, and it's like, what the hell can happen? I need to just get rid of this stuff in my stomach, so it just flushes it out. we'll just do a couple more on here. So George, eating before swimming, again, like with any exercise, eating before a session, I would say, like, one, personal preference is going to be a big thing. Like, some people can eat half an hour before. I like to have about 90 minutes before I do a session, especially swimming. I don't know why, but I just like to be about 2 hours before I have a swim if I'm going to have something full, which is why I then just have a quick swig of protein if I swim in the mornings. Your fuel throughout the day is going to be what makes more of a difference than eating before the swim and what. Having, like, as we've said, having like banana and protein shake if you don't want a whole lump of food beforehand. Chocolate rice cakes are really good. Try and get like the milk chocolate ones rather than the dark chocolate ones. It's tastier. White chocolate orange. I think you can get caramel ones. Some really good choices of different rice cakes to have there. Chuck some peanut butter on them. Another thing which is good for during your rides is just literally just like having like Nutella on dried fruit. Just like chuck it in a bag and like it's going to get sticky and whatever, but screw it. It tastes bloody good and it helps fuel you. So dried fruit is going to be great as well. So Alex, you mentioned about the gels on the ride. This is a little bit like Dave's question with the nutrition whilst training. So with that, basically, it's not necessarily going to be the gels. It's going to be the way that they transport into the stomach and into the muscles. So you want to just try and make sure that you're not gulping loads of water and have something like some glutamine in the water, about 5 grams, a little teaspoonful is pretty good. That's going to be really good to put in there. As for natural food, again, like the bike bags and like saddle seats are going to be really good nowadays. You can even like chuck something like, if you can handle a sandwich on a bike, cool. If you're good with bread, you're good with gluten, cool. Try and keep it as whole food as possible. Bananas, apart from that video of that guy that was having like 30 bananas a day, that was just like, no, that's just weird, wrong. Like, why? And yeah, he was just a bit crazy about that. I think he was like an Australian guy. If any of you have seen it, just had loads of bananas. But bananas are good. Dried fruit is really good. Figs are really great. Just don't eat too many, please, because I just wouldn't want to be behind you when you've eaten too many of them. Honestly, real talk. So dried fruit, getting fluid in your energy bottle. So something like a good electrolyte, aminos, like amino acids are marketed towards bodybuilding, but they're really crap for bodybuilding, really, because you're training for what, an hour and a half if you're doing a bodybuilding session, and you're going to be able to just use your food around the session. You don't necessarily need too much during the session. So aminos are very good for sparing your muscle, and they taste good as well. So even if you've just got water in your bottle, chuck a spoonful of aminos in there and you can get some really nice flavors. So what we need to do now, as we've said, is the free training giveaway. Now, I've been through like a few of them. I'm not going to go into the details about why people have said it, because some people have said some really good ideas, and I don't want to go through like and say what people's different things are. So let me get the folder up. I've just moved it down so I can answer the questions. One moment. Okay, so I better just make sure they're on the call, actually. So the guy that I want to be working with, not necessarily because it's a guy or a girl, I'm not sexist or anything, but the story just really resonated with myself, is Alex Bow. So Alex, I'll drop you a message on over an email. It'll be afterwards, just to obviously just make sure you're cool and you want to look for the nutrition program, and then tomorrow I'll send you the documents over as well, and we can get started and hop on Skype. But remember, like, I still want to make sure that you guys get the most out of this. So with that, what I want to happen is, yes, Alex is like, he's now going to be able to get his nutrition fully tailored. He's going to be able to get the plans like made for him and know exactly what foods he eats. But you guys can actually still get on the call with me and we can just chat and we can just see whether there's something that you guys want to do as well. Because you know that it's going to be the right thing for you, but potentially you're a little bit worried that your family might not be able to like justify you paying for it. It's going to help them as well. And we want to make sure things are right for you. So let's just chat on the phone and get that nutritional consultation and get that through to make sure there are some things that we can do straight there and then. All right. So I look forward to speaking to a hell of a lot of you guys and really seeing what we can do in nutrition. I'm excited for it. Very excited. I mean, some of the races you guys are doing, like, yeah, it's amazing. So you're inspirational to me. I want to help you become even more inspirational to others. So thank you for joining me, and I look forward to speaking to you guys soon.